Hi, I'm Jesper Pedersen from KDAB. We are watching programming with Qt and QML. We made it almost through this module now. We've seen lots of interesting stuff. We've seen the list view with the grid view, the path view. We've seen the repeater element. Remember that one? That was a pretty unique element that spit out other elements. When we saw the repeater element, one of the things that we saw was the column and rows and grid. They are called the positioners. I would like to end this module by killing those from your memory, or at least reminding you there are alternatives to them. What we're going to see in this module is qt-quick.layouts. That's the import statement for these special elements that we're going to see now. Or, well, they are elements, they are layout managers. So we actually seen, let me see, four ways of laying out your elements. The first way, do it manually, X, comma, Y, and with an it. Second way is using our anchor layout, so anchoring things to one side or to the other side. Then we saw the positioners, the rows and the columns, and you create elements and they will show up in a row or a column or a grid. And now we're going to see the last one and the difference for the third one. Was not really a layout manager, it was just a positioner. Because at least in my book, a layout manager is something that position and resizes your elements. So let's see what that looks like. As I said, our layout manager here, they both position and resize your element. And resizing the element is for you, you can do stuff like a layout.fillWidth. So for the element that you put into your layout manager, for a specific element, you can say, hey, you should fill the whole width or the whole height in this layout cell. The items can specify some requirements on how big or how small they would like. So layout minimum width, layout minimum height, layout maximum width, and layout maximum height. They can also do what, at least from the Qt widget world, was known as a size hint. You can say, you can specify the implicit width and the implicit height. And finally, you can specify layout preferred width and preferred height. And actually I was wrong there. The size hint is more like the preferred width and preferred height. And this is where you'll ask yourself, so what's the difference between implicit width and height and preferred width and height? Well, that depends on which hat you have on. If you have the hat on that you are the guy or the girl or whatever who's implementing this new element, so you're implementing a button for lack of imagination here, then you are the one who will ask yourself, what would be a good size for this? And we had a video earlier on where we actually saw the implicit width and implicit height, so that's just a link here. In that video, we saw that if you do not get the implicit width and implicit height correct, then you're likely going to end up with something that's 0 by 0. And using a button that is 0 pixels width is not all that easy. The preferred width and preferred height, however, is you when you have the other hat on, so this one over here, that says, hey, I'm a user of this button component that one of my coworkers created. So when you're a user, the button already have the implicit width and the implicit height, but you can say in my scene here, it would look better if it was 20 pixels bigger. So you create your preferred width or preferred height. One thing to notice when you look at this is that the layout.fillWidth and layout maximum height and layout preferred height, they all say layout dot. That's because these are attached properties to your element. So again, if you go and look at, say, button or from Qt Quick Controls, or if you go and look at a rectangle, the rectangle do not have a fill height or a maximum height or whatever. These are attached properties that the layout offers us. Let's see what it looks like in action here. So the first layout we have, let me just run the example so you can see it. There really isn't more to it than what meets the eye here. So I got a column with two rows inside. Here's my column. This is my first row here and my second row down here. And the two row on top of each other is your column. My column layout obviously needs to fill itself inside its parent, which happened to be the main window in this example here, but still anchors.fill. So there's nothing that prevents you from using both anchors and other layout, as in this example here, our column layout in the same application. It has 5 pixels of margin, that is those 5 pixels that you'll see right around here. And this line edit doesn't go all the way to the edge, there's 5 pixels of margin there too. Now here's our row layout. That is our file name and our text field next to each other. So I create my label, I create my text field. Both comes from Qt Quick Control. My row layout itself is laid out inside the column layout. So it says layout.align, Qt.align top, which is why this whole row layout is aligned to the top of the window. I create my label. Nothing needs to be done there. I create my text field. And for my text field to take the whole width of what is left after the label, I say layout.fill with true. Again, that's the attached properties we have there. Then I create the row for these two down here. I say layout.alignment, Qt.align bottom, or Qt align right. That's the bitwise or there, which means that it's aligned at the bottom and at the right. I create my OK and cancel button, and there really isn't more to say to this than that. My Qt Quick layout also come with a grid layout that is way, way more powerful than your regular positioner grid that we've seen in previous videos. So let's actually just go to the code here and see that right away. So if we run the code, and we go over here, so we are using a tab widget here. And the page we're looking at is this one here with a grid. Include Qt Quick 2.0, that's your usual Qt Quick for item and whatnot. Qt Quick Controls 1.2, that is our button and our line edit and what we have there. And finally, Qt Quick .layout 1.1, that is where our layout managers are. I got an item at the top, 600 by 400, and inside that item, I have a grid layout. And if I just collapse this one, you can see that's everything there is to it. My grid layout needs to anchor again itself in its parent. So anchor fill parent, anchor margin 5. So again, we have 5 pixels between here and 5 pixels up there and so on. There's 3 columns in this grid layout. 1 column, 2 column, 3 column. And the grid layout has this facility of auto positioning. So if you do not specify a position, it will just add it to the grid. So button here, button 1, layout to fill with, which is what makes it fill the whole cell here. Button 2, button 3, button 4, but hey, 4, if you only have 3 columns, that's why I ended up down on my next row with this button. I can also do a specific placement as you see here. So here's a button and I say explicit layout.row should be 1, layout.column should be 2. So 1 and 2, that's this one over here that has the text 5. And after that, I can continue on flowing. So file here is just added with another label and it ends up at this cell here. I have the text field here that spans two columns, so 1, 2 column is spanned here, and it fills the whole width over that distance. Then I got another label that is called comment here, and then finally my text area that is sitting here, the text area is spanning 2 column and 2 rows, so 2 column here and 2 rows, and it should fill the width and the height of these things. So as I started out saying, the positioners have some shortcomings. They are, what do I know, 5, 6, 7 years older than Qt Quick layouts. So you're likely not going to use the positioner except in rare situations. Let's just highlight at the end of this video here, what is the difference between a positioner and a layout manager? First of all, the layout manager resizes, as I have the facility of resizing the children, the positioner doesn't. Of course, you can anchor your items when you position them in, for example, a column. You can anchor it to parent left and parent right. But by default, there is nothing built into the positioner for that. You can specify alignment, as we saw. You can align to the layout or individual items in their layout cell. You can target the specific row and column. So you can say this particular label needs to show up in row number 8, column number 3. And finally, as we saw with the grid layout, and also with the row and column, you can span them over multiple multiple cells. It would almost feel like if I was advertising gamma ray here, if I showed you yet another example of gamma ray. So I'll let you try that yourself. But when you have gamma ray, it's actually pretty useful that when you have something in your layout and you're saying, why are there blank pixels here? I thought this or that would fill those blank pixels. Bring up the gamma ray, go into the Qt quick scenes, choose the picker and just click on that pixel that you thought would be something. And right away there in your object tree, you can see, oh, so it's that element that owns that pixel. Very useful tool. That's it for this module. And now, in the next module, we're going to go down on the C++ level. We're going to see all the glue going on the C++ level. Boys with toys, can I say? We'll see all the glue that goes on the C++ level. And after that, the next module is going to be the integration between C++ and QML. But we cannot get to that integration before we understand everything that goes on in that glue. So stay tuned. Please do subscribe to our channel. You will be the first person to know when that next video comes out. Thank you very much and have a great time until we'll see you again.